Wondering, I had to bring some of my work with me this morning, but I was wondering, could somebody look after him for me? Anybody want to? Here you go. Just don't open his bottom drawer. He gets sensitive about that. Little Juddy. Okay, do I have a clicker? Where's my clicker? Right here. Okay, I'm Judson. Does anybody know who I am? Anybody? I know Danielle knows me. There you go. Okay. Yeah, I'm a little bit different. Let's see if this thing, does this work? How does this thing go? There we go. Nope. Yeah, okay, so when Mark asked me to do this, this was about a year ago now, wasn't it, Mark? And I said, shock. I thought, oh, God, is it Halloween? I'm going to wear a costume. I'm going to be like a big scary monster. So I thought, well, let's just go back and go to the dictionary and find out what shock actually means. And it says, a sudden upsetting or surprising event or experience, a sudden or violent disturbance of the mind, emotion, or sensibilities. Objective, to collide violently, to strike or jar with intense surprise, horror, disgust, etc. I hope I'm none of those. Maybe the surprise one. To design and build furniture that explodes, melts, twists, and sometimes pees on the carpet. That's it. Okay, so let's start here. No, that's me again. Nope, I'm going the wrong way. Okay. Okay, when I was about 18, I barely graduated from high school. I just did not like high school. I was bored. You know, I wasn't a bad kid. I had hair down here, but anyway, so I finally graduate from high school, and I start a career delivering pizzas and washing cars for a living, and I'm pretty good at it. Of course, I'm the baby of the family, and about a year and a half is going by, and I'm quite content delivering pizzas, you know, doing the car wash thing. And so my parents, you know, being the baby, I'm the last one out of the house. And I remember my dad came home. I was having breakfast at about noon, eating my Cheerios. And my dad came home from work. And, you know, my dad never came home from work. He was working all the time. And he was a suit and tie guy, you know, real, you know, business guy, briefcase and all that. And he comes in the house. I'm still in my underwear. And he says, Judson, I've signed you up for art school. And I said, what? What are you talking about, art school? I didn't know a thing about art or... I says, I don't care, you're going to do something with your life, I'm sending you up to art school. And I said, the classes are going to start in about a half an hour, and I'm going to drive you there at Cap College and make damn sure you get in that class. Well, you can imagine what I'm thinking, Dad, you know, back off, you know. Anyways, with a little bit of wrestling, he gets me in the car, and I got some clothes on, takes me down to Cap College, and I remember the classes had already started. It was after 1 o'clock in the afternoon. He was banging on doors looking for these classes that he had set me up for. Anyways, we're banging on doors. No, that isn't the door. That isn't the door. And then finally we come to the door, and he opened it up, and I walk in, and there's a nude woman standing right in the middle of the room. And she winks at me. And I said to myself, I think I'm going to try this art school stuff. So, you know, it was a kind of a funny thing, but... what was interesting about it, let's see what else I got. Yeah, here I am, look at that. That's 1978. Look at that hair. Come on, look at those shoes. Anyways, that's where I was at back then. Anyways, I went to Cap College for a couple years, took life drawing classes, took printmaking classes, and I also took a painting class. And do we have any painters here just by hands? Because I really admire people that can paint on a flat surface and make it come to life. Unfortunately, I wasn't much of a painter. I remember I had my canvas, and I started taking wood out of the garbage and gluing it on the canvas. And I think my painting teacher at that point said, Judd, I don't think painting's where you should be going. I think you should try sculpture. And of course, stupid me, what's sculpture? What is that, like clay and chip and stone? I didn't have a clue. And they said, no, you should check it out. They have a full wood shop in the basement. And I'm thinking, a wood shop? I love woodworking and all that. So I did the Cap College thing and dropped all my classes and totally concentrated on sculpture. Then I moved on to Emily Carr, which I didn't even know where that, I was so naive, and I guess I still am, but when they said, I said, where's the art school? They said, it's on the island. I said, what island? Like Vancouver Island, you know, Bowen Island. And they said, no, Granville Island. I didn't know where the heck that was. Anyways, it was the second year of the school, it was moved down to the Granville Island. And I took all sculpture, and I was just trying everything. I mean, I wasn't about quality, it was about quantity. I just made tons of stuff. It was just slapping stuff together. But then I started to realize, no, I got to kind of focus in, and I started making boxes. I figured if you can learn to build a box, you can make anything. I mean, we're inside a box right now, so I figured if you can make a box, you can make anything. So I started making these minimal art pieces, and I was a big fan of Donald Judd, and he did these minimal art pieces. So, yeah, that's a piece there. So I was making a bunch of these, and people were coming up to me going, hey, how much for that coffee table? And I said, excuse me? What did you say? This is my art. He says, no, I can put my feet on it. I can put my coffee on it. I go, No, no, it's art. You just look at it and enjoy it. And the guy goes, no, no, that would look really cool in my apartment. I'll give you $400 for it. I'm like, okay. Starting to get the, so something I would have done for free and still do for free sometimes. I mean, the fact that you make something and it's functional as well. So I went to my art teacher, and this is back when it was just sculpture and printmaking, silk screen and graphic design. That was all Emily Carr was. So I said to my teacher, hey, can I sell these as furniture? And he goes, absolutely not. You're an artist, and that's what you do. I said, yeah, but I got to make a living. You know, this is kind of quick. Nope, it's either art or go to a furniture school or wait 20 years and come back to Emily Carr and you can take a furniture course. So anyway, so that was the debate there. Is it sculpture or is it furniture? Now, this day, we could just go to Google and it would be right in front of you. We had to go to the library and at the school, and I couldn't find anything as art as furniture. Furniture's art. And then I found, I hope it's the next slide. Oh, here's some more of my pieces. Here we go. Yeah. I was working with copper and laminate and paint. Yeah, so this is the only thing I could find in the library that was, art is furniture, furniture art. And this is an artist named Wendell Castle. He's still alive. He's still making stuff in his early 80s. But this is called Ghost Clock, and that's all wood. The fabric, everything is carved wood. And I was in Washington, D.C. at the Smithsonian, and I didn't know this piece was in the Smithsonian. And I walk up, and there it is in front of me. And I set off every alarm in the building. I mean, they had security guards running at me because I wanted to touch it. Because I guess there was a laser beam around it or something, but I was like, zing, you know. But it was amazing. Even the string, the folds, everything. So I started to research more on him. In fact, he did a series of clocks and furniture, and he's still doing it to this day. So that was my ticket in. I figured if he can do it, I guess I've got a shot. So the teachers, I told him to go, you know, I'm just going to keep doing it. And funny, in my fourth year, people were driving by and buying stuff right out of the school. Like, it was like a production, like, oh, here's your piece. It's, yeah. Teachers didn't like that. But I'll give you one. Is anybody still in school at Emily Carr or Langara or anything like that? Well, one thing is, I treated my last year at art school like I was going to work. I wanted that attitude, like, because, you know, you leave school and then where do you go? So my teachers were my bosses and I was making stuff. Okay, now here's the next big question. I've graduated from art school, now what do you do? What do you do? They don't tell you that. There's no little, oh, by the way, do this. You know, they say bye. So I was really bummed out because I really loved art school. I loved Emily Carr more than anything. It was just the best of my life. It changed my, you know, everything. So what do you do? Let's see, what did I do? I don't even know. Okay, you find an old warehouse. Now, does anybody know where 1000 Parker Street is? Okay, it still looks like this. This is from 1923. There was a little ad in the Vancouver Sun. It said art studios for rent. Well, I just happened to be the very first person in that building. Like, it was empty, it was condemned, there was no windows, there was no light, no heat, lots of rats, lots of prostitution. Oh, it was a hoot. Anyways, let's see what it looks like. So I move into the building, and it has no, so one thing about a studio is I get the first pick, but there was no lights or no, one little light bulb, I think. Anyways, I started drilling holes in the wall and putting little red flags out because I didn't know where I was in the building. So when I looked around the back, oh, there was window frames and all that. So I started ripping all the old drywall and all the wood, everything that was protecting it, all that. We started opening up the windows, And all of a sudden, we had light, and we had studios. And then, of course, word of mouth hit, and the place filled up with artists. So what's better for a person who just graduated from art school, who's alone, and all of a sudden you're in a room full or a building full of artists? And I can still remember running upstairs to cut a piece of wood and then running back down to my studio because I didn't have a table saw. And people were, we would just borrow and share and cry and drink and try to figure out this art game. And it was, I think it was the biggest influence in my life was to find that building. And I think we're better in numbers. Look, we're in a room full of people here. We're all networking. We're all have something in common. And I think that's really, really important. So arts, that art school and then finding 1000 Parker Street was a big deal. And I just celebrated my 30th anniversary there this month, so, or last month. So that's pretty, yeah, thank you. Thank you. What a shock. Okay, so now I'm in my build. What am I going to do? I got the studio. I don't know what I'm doing. So I keep making these silly boxes. And my dad, the only advice he gave me, he says, incorporate your company. You've got to be a company. And I said, well, why? He said, well, incorporate yourself. They can't sue you or whatever kind of nonsense. He was probably right. So I made these. I had to come up with a name. Come up with a name. What am I going to call myself, you know? And I said, Straight Line Designs Incorporated. Perfect. Straight to the point. Straight online, straight goods. Anyway, so I did that. And then, of course, I started putting legs, and I started getting more furniture. Like, the idea was I was going to finance my art career. That's what I wanted to do. I wanted to be an artist, but I figured in the beginning I'm going to have to do whatever it takes. Picket fences, God, storefronts, whatever. But luckily, people started, what's under that blanket? And they liked that better than what they were asking for. So I'm doing Straight Line Designs for about 4 years. And I started to question, why does everything have to be straight? Look at this room. Straight, straight, straight. Except this, I love this back wall. That's really cool. So that's what I questioned that. So I decided to follow Alice down the rabbit hole and ended up in Toontown. Does anybody remember this movie, Who Framed Roger Rabbit? This is before DVDs, before VHS. I had to sit in the movie theater and watch that 5-minute segment of Toontown and then sneak back in, and I must have watched it about 12 times. And I kept looking at it, and the buildings were moving, they had eyes in the windows, and I just said, I think this is something. I think I'm going to try to do this as furniture. So here's the very first curve piece I did. And if anybody was at IDS West this week, and I actually had it on display at my booth, so I was showing my vintage furniture from 1991. And that's cool when you get old, you can become vintage. I thought that was really cool. Hey, man, I'm vintage. What are you? You're nothing. You're just a baby. I'm vintage. Check it out. So I started making these silly things with faces and eyes. And the only rule I had for myself is it had to be functional. It had to have drawers or something in it. So even the old TV set with the rabbit ears, even that opens up like a drawer like that. So that was kind of cool. And the other thing about making furniture like this is people either, they get kind of angry or they get, like the guys get mad at me. They go, why are you doing that? That's not how you make furniture. And I said, what, is there a rule book? Did somebody come up with a book that I didn't get? You know, does Amazon have a book on that? No, there is no rule to it, but they were frustrated at me, like, stop doing that, Judd. And of course, the more they told me not to do it, well, I had to cover my butts. I had to keep doing it. I'll show you. This will work out. Anyway, this is one. This is a piece of furniture about to explode. And there we go. Boom. So there we go. Now, everything works. Everything's functional. How are we doing for time? I got a little story about this. Are we okay? Okay. I take this piece to New York City that the ICFF show, along with my other silly furniture. And the New York Times magazine comes up to their press people and say, Mr. Beaumont, we'd love to do a story about your furniture. And I'm thinking, oh, God. This is so cool. You know, this is New York, the press, it's all good. So I give them my little CD. I think that was when we gave CDs out. Is there a press kits or some stupid thing? Anyways, the show's over. You know, it's a good show. We pack up. I jump on a plane. I go back to Vancouver. But I've got lots of friends in New York. So, of course, the article's going to come out on the Saturday. So I had to wait. And I phoned my friends. I said, did the paper come out? Did you see it? And they go, yeah. I said, well, Judd, okay, I said, well, come on. They said, well, luckily there's no pictures of your work in the newspaper. And I was kind of bummed out by that. I was like, well, I thought they were going to put my picture in there. Well, it turns out the story was about what they hated at the ICFF show, what they thought was horrible. And I went, really? And they put in, I should get the little article, but it says, this artist, Judson Beaumont, is making fun of 9/11. Can you believe that? The kids in army fatigues. I mean, come on. Couldn't believe it. It was a real kick, a real... But anyways, you learn from that, I guess. I don't know. Oh, yeah, there it is, all on the ground. That's all. But everything works. That's the key. Okay, of course, and I did a lot of... Once you let the floodgates open and you're shocking or you're trying to create different things, the sky's the limit. So I always looked at a piece of furniture. What if it exploded? What if it melted? So this is my melting piece. And at some point when I do my talks, there's a hand that comes up in the back row. And I'll say, yes, what was the question? They'll say, have you ever done acid, man? Like, what? You know, because, you know, no, but I've never done acid. I don't even know what. Is it come in a bottle? I don't know. But it's, you know, acid. Do I do drugs? Do I smoke dope? And no, I don't do any of that stuff. So a few beers maybe. But. Okay. Of course, starting a business and you start doing different things and trying to promote yourself and all that. And remember the Soapbox Derby races at Kitsilano? Remember those? And it was all gravity-driven kind of thing. Well, I got a little carried away. A little bit too much. You know how there's hockey dads in hockey? Well, there's soapbox derby dads in soapbox derby racing. They took one look at this and said, are those hydraulic brakes on that thing? Do you have rack and pinion steering in that thing? Is that a carrot? You know. It's a 24 carat. And my, we raced it, and I should have sculpted a slug. Because it was incredibly slow. I mean, it was the last one through the finish line. But we won all the trophies for best design, which kind of made me feel good. So there's my son. He's about 8 years old. He's 24 now or something. But he's in that thing racing this. And it's his best design goes to, you know, Taylor Beaumont, blah, blah, blah. So he goes up there. He gets his big trophies. It's bigger than he is. And I'll never forget this. He comes up to me and he gives me this big hug. And he goes, Dad, I couldn't have done it without you. I said, you're damn right you couldn't have done it without you. That's $10,000 worth of carrot in there. Tell me about couldn't have done it without you. Anyways, here's my little dog, Dewey. This was a piece that I did, again, I was drawing. We're going to talk about drawing in a little bit. But I drew a chair, a club chair, but I kept it completely hollow. I just did the outside line of it. And I thought, wouldn't that be cool or interesting if you just took out 90% of the bulk of an upholstered club chair and kept it empty? So you can put your dog in there, or you can put books in there, or you can put firewood in there. So that was what that's what I did with that. And also I'm working on, talk about doing charity work, I'm starting to make them with plastic, a clear plexiglass front and back, and slots in the arms. And so you sit in it and you can put money in it. And you call it a charity. Huh? Come on. Come on. Somebody. I didn't come up with that name. Some drunk at the bar that I hang out with said, that's a charity. And I went, yeah, that's great. Anyways. Here's another shocking piece I did. This looks fairly normal to everybody here, but that's all wood. The whole thing is CNC cutout wood. And what I don't tell anybody that it's wood, so when they sit on it, they really crack their butt on that, and they get really angry with me. Like, why did you do that? Because I wanted to, but it hurt. I said, well, too bad. Tell your friends. Okay, so here's another one. And people, and this is where I make things. And some guy, it's always a guy, and he says, why would you, no, I can understand you maybe draw, but why would you bother to build it? I said, because I want to. And he goes, what's the point? It's crazy. And then I go, yeah, whatever. But anybody says, what's the hole for? And I can, oh, well, you put your dirty clothes through that. I don't know where they go, but they just throw them in there, and they just find their way back pressed and clean. Or you could put wine in there, or you could do whatever you want. But it's not about... I mean, it's functional, it works, and all that kind of stuff. So, now here's a funny. How am we doing for time? I don't want to. I mean, everybody's got to go. Okay, everybody okay? If Mark says it's okay, you're staying. Okay, now I want to make a piece that springs. I want to have show movement in my furniture, like a Jack in the Box or whatever. So I go down. There's one guy in Richmond who makes springs. Any size spring you want, little ones, big ones, whatever. I walk in there and I say, I want the biggest spring you make. And he goes, what are you gonna do with it? What do you care? I just want to buy one. No, I won't sell it to you. I said, "When I got to know what you're gonna, what do you think I'm gonna jump off a roof and bounce around the city?" Really? He was like, "Well, you know, I don't mean to be liable. Kids jumping off bridges and stuff." So he wouldn't. I drew a picture. Nope. So I actually built the top and the bottom. Went back down to his shop and said, "I want a spring to go in there." He goes, "Okay, I'll do it." Yeah. So I had no idea if it was gonna work or not. So it bounced around, but if you push down on it, it bounces around the room. So it's really cool. You don't want to have anybody below you in your apartment, but that's what it does. Yeah. Here's one, a bit of fiberglass and wood. And I got inspired by eating an apple one day, okay? That's what happened. I'm just chopping. And even the handles are bitten too, so that's kind of fun. Here's a beaver cabinet. Now this is a really, real cute story. I'm in New York again, because I'm too dumb to quit. I go back to New York at the ICFF show, and who comes by? My idol, Wendell Castle, the guy that made the ghost clock. He's walking down towards me. I'm like, "Oh my God, it's Wendell Castle." So I come up and I say, "Hey, Wendell, you know, nice to meet you." He goes, and he actually says, "Yeah, I know your work. I've seen your work." I was like, "Oh, that's cool." And I said, "What do you think?" He goes, "Oh, I love it, but it's not me, it's my wife." And all of a sudden, dun, 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 she comes. And she's looking at it, and she's just got a scowl on her face. And she opens up the door and goes, "There's dirt in there." She closes it and walks on. That was so cool. And Wendell just rolled his eyes. Now you know what I deal with. Okay. I've made a lot of silly... I made a piece of furniture that looked like a puppet. It was all on strings and cables. It was the dumbest. Don't ever... If anybody's thinking of making puppet furniture, it's been done. It went horribly wrong. So, but what came from that? I'm always thinking, even a bad idea is good. I don't mind when I've had a lot of failures, believe me. But failures are good too, because it just inspires you not to go down that road. Go back over here. But what inspired me was this hanging this little black dresser. And it's been a huge hit, and it totally came from that puppet stuff I was trying to do. So, and this is kind of not even a kid's, because I've kind of been known as the children's furniture designer guy. But this one kind of branched me out a little bit and made it a bit more sophisticated. So I make lots of those. Oh, there we go. There's Dewey again. I'm showing you this because I'm not a furniture designer, and I'm all kinds of things. But this piece, just because it's so whimsical and weird and wacky, has got me more work and more from, I was on Good Morning America, and I met Disney and big name Karela Kranz. I met a lot of big companies because of this piece. It got written up in so many magazines, and so it was, it's not about the doghouse. I'll make fun, okay. It's not about the doghouse, it's just the idea behind it, and it was a very successful piece for me. And I wanted to show that as, you know, sometimes you gotta go above and beyond to promote your stuff, even if that's not what you really do. It's like, you know, I'm a furniture maker, but hey, check this thing out. So it got a lot of people to my website and my blog and all that. Okay, oh, there he is in the back. Look at that face. A little license plate. Now here's one I wanna, by hands, I'll be honest, how many people own sketchbooks? Well, that's not bad. I did a group a couple of weeks ago to an architectural firm. Like two people put their hands up, two, in a big room like this. Sketching is so important. I know you want to go right to your computers and go, but sketching is fun, it's relaxing. You can just, you know, I just paint with, like, one day I just did all with a purple pencil, all day, which is purple. Everything was purple. And the next day, everything was a ballpoint pen. Change it up a little bit. Here's some of my sketches so you don't think I'm doing anything here. So. And I'm trying to be silly. I'm not trying to draw a pretty picture. I'm just trying to get ideas out of my head and on the paper right away. Here's hanging furniture out to dry. You never know. And it could happen. This guy's down in his luck. He's got no face. Yeah. This looks like a hot plate incident. I'm not sure. How about burying the furniture? Let's bury the furniture for a couple of years, then dig it up and clear coat it. It'll be great. Be different. That's the fun thing about furniture or drawing. You don't have to do anything. This is a furniture accident. So it was a terrible day. How about furniture at the, you know, by the pool? You know, what's this furniture thing? Like, it's got to stay in your house all year long. Take it out. Take your furniture out. They appreciate it. Here's a birdhouse. I was drawing, when I get stuck on a night, this is a good tip. If you got a big assignment you got to get done and you're really stuck and you can't figure it out, draw something completely different. So I just drew hundreds of birdhouses, and then from that, I actually made a birdhouse with a pool on the roof. So that was good. How about an eye log? Huh? Where's all you green people? Come on. I couldn't believe that you make this beautiful little iPad and they put it in a big plastic box. So we went ahead and did that, put that in. And it worked. It was a little tinny, but it worked. And people said, where's the sound coming from? From the little holes there, you know? What shocks Judd? Oh boy, everything. Rent. everything. Okay, these are things when I was growing up. Everybody's Salvador Dali. I mean, to this day, people, you're like Salvador Dali, but you're also like Bugs Bunny. Okay. This is my favorite architect, everybody, Frank Gehry. Now, what's cool about this, Frank, you know, a lot of people don't know this, Frank did shopping centers for 25, 30 years. That's all he did was shopping centers. But he bought a little house in Santa Monica, which I kind of hang around when I'm down in LA. But what he did is he bought a pink house and they built around it. So the pink house still exists. The kitchen in front is where the driveway was. So it's still got tar on the ground and all that. But he's actually had people take shots at his house with guns. Like they're so mad at him. He's got a guy across the street that has a bunch of those 18-wheeler, those big trailers, those campers. And he's always working on it. So he's saying, get that, that's not how you make the houses. And he goes, well, look at your house. You've got a bunch of traders in your front yard. He says, well, but they're okay. They're acceptable. And no way. So anyways, we all know what Frank's done and where he's going. And I've actually met him a couple times. And it's just like, I'm just like a little schoolgirl when I meet him. Like, hey. He doesn't like that. Ron Arad. He's another crazy furniture guy. And this is tempered steel. So when you sit on it, you bounce around. Now this is so weird. I'm in Chicago at the museum, big fans, and this is on display and you cannot touch it. You cannot look at it. You can look at it, but you can't touch it. They got a big rope around it. And I thought, geez, I'd sure like to sit on that chair, but I don't want to set any alarms off, as I'm known to do. So I go to the local McDonald's down the street. Now this is no word of a lie. I'm not a big McDonald's guy, but I went down there. They had five of these in the McDonald's. And people were sitting on them, spilling ketchup on them. So I got to sit on one anyways. And it's just awkward, it's just like, ooh. But they took a McDonald's in right downtown Chicago and put all the famous furniture designers in the world in there. I don't know who came up with that idea, but it was so cool, but the smell, you know, we didn't, took the edge off. Okay, everybody know Mark Newsom? He did this when he was 19. He was going to be a jewelry, make jewelry. This piece is now worth 2.4 million pounds. Whoa. This piece. Can you believe that? That shocks me. So I got a long way to go to get up to that level. But of course, Philip Stark, the juicer that doesn't work. Everybody has one, but it doesn't work. Isn't that amazing? And then I love, this is another Stark piece in Japan. He did a beer hall, and that's a 90-foot. He calls it a flame. I don't know what it is, but it's all gold leafed. And talk about it, you know, you look at the skyline of Tokyo and you see this yellow blip in there. It's pretty impressive. I think we're just about done. Yes, I think this is one of my last year. I got invited to go to Hong Kong and they put a display of they put Judd Land in the shopping mall. Instead of a Christmas display at Christmas time, they had a Judd display in summertime. And on the last day I was there, these kids came out, or last day I was young. I was there for 2.5 weeks, and these kids put on a dance routine dressed as my furniture. And I just flipped out. It was unbelievable. And do we have a little blurb on this, do we? Let's see. Let's see if I can click this one more time. Yeah, look at that. And they were so beautifully made.
Five, six, seven, eight.
There you go. It went on for 8 minutes. They did a whole routine. It was 8 minutes. Every day at noon they did this. And I said to myself, man, when I started, and to think that my furniture actually did come to life, I thought that was pretty interesting. What's next? Real quick. I'm doing a place at YVR Airport that's going to be out next month. November 2nd. Here's me sticking my head out there. Okay, there's the inside. Somebody likes JB. I'm working on a kid's book, and what I like about it was you're born, you're one drawer old, you're two drawers, then you're three drawers, and then you start to grow. And what makes you feel good is soft, clean underwear and socks and pants. That's the idea. We're working still rough. And here's some little animated, so maybe it'll be a Pixar movie one day. And this is another piece I'm working on, jumping furniture. And in closing, I always say love what you do. If you don't love it yet, learn to love it, because it's fun to go to work every day. So there you go. Thanks very much. Is that okay?
I want to ask you, I got Genesis from here. What did you get in art school?
I learned how to look at things differently. That's it. I mean, art school just is, they're not going to make you a better artist or a better designer or a better builder. It was you got to figure it out, and they're just there to kind of, okay, try again. No, I just started looking at the world differently. And I'm not being all weird and spiritual, but
so have you ever told your dad that you were grateful that
I've never talked to him since. No. I think he's 86 now or something. No, pretty well every day. Yeah, when I won an achievement award last year, I had to go up on stage and thank people. And my mom had just passed away. And I knew I was going to start crying. I knew I was just going to start bawling my head off. Nobody wants to hear somebody going, nah, nah, nah. You know, nobody likes that sound. So I made a joke about the Don Henley, that people in New York thought I was Don Henley walking down the street and taking my picture. So that kind of got the laugh out of the way. And then I went, I looked like my mom and my dad. And then, you know, everybody else. So. But no, I totally, but it's a funny career, because I don't know anybody that was forced, hand-dragged down to an art school. I'm the first one, you know. Please leave art school. Please don't go to art school. Yeah. But look at things differently.
Okay. Judd.
Yes.
Carlin. Nope. Judd, you have another legacy you're talking about here at this time, but yeah. You have hired so many people to work with you.
Yes.
And I wonder if you could just speak a little bit too about why you continue to hire all these people. It's not just because of the workload, I know that.
You know, it's a funny thing. People say, why don't you hire old people? Why don't you hire young people? It's people that can work with me, and I'm teaching them a different way of working, building. We don't build normal things. We don't build kitchens. We don't build stuff like, you know, cabinets. So I have to get them young and eager and exciting. What happens, and of course with everything, is their egos get out of control. And they start telling me, no, Judd, that's not how we're going to make it. We're going to make it this way. And then you know it's time for them to kind of move on. So there's kind of you get about three or four good years, and then they start Instagramming my work and showing my work as their own. And you just sort of go, really? Really? Come on, you know. So it's a problem. But I love young people. And I think it is kind of a school I've got going. It's not registered, but the straight line school of figure your life out. No, I love young people. I love working with them. And my brother was a teacher, my sister was a teacher, and I don't consider myself a, you know, today we're going to talk about this, you know. But I do, I run into people that worked with me 10, 15 years ago and go, oh, God, Judd, now I get it. I know what you were trying. You were trying to get me to push me harder to do better, and I just didn't. And now I work at the airport punching tickets all day or something, you know, which is kind of sad. Yeah. Unless you're in the airport.
Another question.
Yeah. Anything? You in the back? Let's do some jumping jacks. Here we go. Oh.
Thank you for your knowledge.
Yes.
My question is, I used to work with refugees in Mozambique.
Bring them over.
Making wooden toys.
Yeah.
I was wondering, do you make wooden toys? Have you had any experience working with homeless people or people?
I make everything. I tried everything once or twice or three times. I've made toys, you know, at Christmas time and stuff like that. I haven't, I think I made some little pine beetle cars. That's right. They look like, you know, Volkswagen Beetles, but they were made out of pine wood. I made a bunch of those one year. I mean, I don't think you can make a lot of money making them. They're more of a, you know, as a gift or a promo thing. But I make all kinds of things. You should come by and look at my sketch. I don't have sketchbooks. I have sketch boxes. I've got so many sketches. So when I'm gone, I want you guys to root through those and keep making them.
How many of you go to the East Side Culture Crawl?
Yeah, how many? I want you to all come this year.
Those that haven't, you must go, because this is a highlight of the entire. Mm.
thing for me. Whenever I go every year, it's
we have beer.
Stop and having a beer with Judd and having a talk. What weird stuff are you working on this week or this month? Who's someone over here?
Yeah. Nobody wants to know my sign.
Yes. I'm curious about how emotion does or does not play out in your work.
Emotion?
Emotion.
It's all emotion. Oh my God, I'm a big baby. I mean, I'm a big softy and then I'm a miserable old goat. You know, it's whatever I got to do to get it done. And we always hit, there's always a part of my designs where we just hit the wall and go, well, that didn't work. You know, that kind of a feel. And we have to fight through it and we have to scrap and argue and then everybody hugs and then we all take pictures and put it on Instagram. Yeah. See, when it's successful, everyone's there to take the credit. And when it's a failure, it's Judd. Judd did it. So it's that kind of a stuff. But that's what happens when you work with a group of people.
What was your name?
Yeah.
That was Catherine.
Thanks, Catherine. Yes. Anybody? Yes.
Hi there.
It's close. Here, where?
Over here.
Oh, there you are. Yeah.
So I was amazed you telling a story about with furniture.
Yeah.
And I was picturing designs in my head.
Yeah.
And I just pictured one thing that doesn't exist yet.
Oh, what is it? I need more ideas.
A furniture design trampoline. Trampoline that's designed kind of like a furniture that you can actually bounce on.
That would be cool.
And you know how kids like bouncing on furniture sometimes.
Yeah.
I think if you can create
I think there'd be a liability thing somewhere in there. But even the springy one that I did that bounced could really knock your teeth out if you weren't looking. But I like the idea of motion and things jumping and flying. Maybe a bungee jump. Maybe I'll throw one off a bridge or something.
Well, I think that would actually become quite popular.
All right. Well, I'll give that consideration. Thank you. Yeah, and you. Yeah, that's right. I'll give you credit.
This young man, by the way, is also one of the interesting Vancouver speakers this year.
Oh.
This is the fifth best pinball player in the world.
Cool. That's very cool.
And the number one in Canada and the North American champion.
Right.
That's Robert Gagnon.
There
is. Somebody to put in the back.
So you seem to really love what you do. Is there anything that you wish you had done instead?
Oh, God. Be a public speaker. No. Oh, God. I don't know. I mean, looking back, you know, so if I could do it all over again, I would do it all over again. I would. Maybe not the dragging and kicking and screaming part, but I think it was, I just knew I was a different kid, not a nerdy, I wasn't smart. I was bored as a kid. I was just bored at everything. I was looking, why do you do that? Why does that, ooh, you go there, you do that, ooh. And I just remember being a little kid and wearing a tie. Good Lord, I have to grow up and wear a tie. It just freaked me out. So, the art school thing, I knew when I got into Cap and Emily Carr, I finally found a group of people that were all a little bit misfits and a little bit odd and a little bit off. And that was the comfort zone. I found my group and that helped a lot. So financing my art career, being a professional artist or a designer, that was, I went at that completely blind. I just did it the way. I don't know how I would do it any other way. I don't think taking a business course or learning the right way to build furniture would have been a good thing for me. I had to figure it all out myself. Because I had an older brother that could build anything, and I always had that, well, he's a good furniture. I can't compete with him. But when I designed my own language and my own way of doing things, it was that. So I think, to answer your question, I would do it all over again, and I can't wait to go to work every day, if that sounds bragging.
Here we go.
Yes.
Hey.
He's got a tie on.
My name is James. I'm an intern architect. And my question, I'm wondering if you have any advice for the creative types in the audience for receiving negative feedback. Say you've got an unorthodox idea, you think it might be good, and you shop it around, and people say, oh, no, that's rather passe. What advice do you have when you receive that kind of feedback?
Well, first of all, don't worry about it. I mean, I get rejected all the time. Believe me. Look at the stuff I make. I remember when I started, I was this young, sensitive little 19, 20-year-old, you know, and I remember going, you know, back to my girlfriend/wife and saying, oh, I got rejected again. I didn't get that project. And I was always so sad. And
hold
depressed.
Hold on.
Yes.
You had a girlfriend and a wife?
Oh, no.
How do you do that?
Well, you live with her and then you marry her a little bit later. So now, you know, when I met my mother and father-in-law for the very first time, I called them mom and dad. They didn't like that. They were not. And they said, what are you taking at school? I'm going to art school. And they went, oh, dear Lord. They were not happy. I don't think, anyways, what was, no, rejection is fantastic. I love it now. The more people go, you suck, you're the worst, takes the pressure off, you know, right? I guess I suck. I go, oh, I'm, you know, and it's okay, but it used to kill me. It would just rip me up inside because I took it so personally. But now when someone says, that really sucks, Beaumont, I just go, okay, bye. You know, like, what am I going to do, okay? No one's going to buy that. That was the big thing. No one would ever buy that. Why would anybody want that? Why would anybody? And all these negative things fueled me. It was just, if you've got a project and someone's going, oh, I don't like it, go to somebody else. Look at all these actors and people, they try out for roles. They never get them. I bet after a while, it's numb to them after a while. They go, I suck. But, you know, you get a little bit of that, little steps, yeah.
Hi, my name is Ender. Yeah. I'm curious about how your process has evolved and, you know, coming tools, things like CNC, complicated shapes.
Yeah, well.
Do you struggle at all with, you know, the idea of, you know, CNC versus art and things like that?
I use all technology. I used to be kind of, I remember a kid came into my studio and said, I can't build anything, but I can take one of your sketches and make it look real. Make it look like it's already been built. And I said, what the hell's the point of that? That's the whole point of making something. You don't know what it's going to look like until you finish it. But he did it, and he put it on the computer, and he spun it around. Ooh, it was really cool. And then I went, yeah, that's great. Okay, I'll never build that piece. Because it's already been built. It's already been, you know. So I like the fun of it. But as far as technology, sure. I mean, when I did that leather bench that wasn't a leather bench, that was a computer. When I made the hollow chair, that's 671 pieces of wood that have to be CNC cut out and clicked together like Lego. I'm all for technology. If it's going to get my idea done, it's all the better. But I still like drawing my furniture full size, putting it on the wall, taking a picture of it, and then scanning it, and then going to the CNC after. I'm open for anything. I don't ignore any kind of 3D printing, although I don't understand it. It takes a long time. You know, I like the process of it, and I've got a funny story. I'm making miniature of one of my pieces, one of my grandfather clocks. It's about 9 inches tall. I got a person to program it for me, and then I had to go to a 3D, why am I using these? 3D, you know, printer. It was so stupid. So I don't meet the guy. You never meet the 3D printer. He must be in a box or something. I don't know where. So you give it to him. You email it to him. And then I went down to pick up the pieces. And it was kind of some kind of surplus store, kind of an odd place. Anyways, I walked in going, "Hi, I'm Judson Beaumont. I'm here for my little tiny clock." And this motherly lady came out. She goes, "Oh, here you go." And I paid for it, 100 and something. And she goes, I'd like to meet Max. I'd like to see Max and take him out for a beer. Maybe we could talk about some other projects. He goes, Max is 13. A 13-year-old kid did it. I couldn't.
13-year-old 3D printer. Yeah, yeah. One more question.
One ten more.
Can I go there? Because okay, I'll do two more. You get the last one.
Okay.
Over here and then over here. Sorry, Craig. You're
I got
too
just
slow.
Just really
you're too
short
slow.
Answers. Like no. Yes.
I'm Amanda.
Hello,
and
Amanda.
Really nice to meet you and hear about you.
Thank you.
Do you sleep?
No. Because my wife snores too much. No. I do, but I don't worry. It's usually solving a problem. Solving, that's something I can't get it out of my head. I'm not one of these guys that gets up and like, you know, jots anything down. I think it's normal. If you're really wound up in what you're doing, deadlines can make you sleepless, but
so
I get enough sleep.
What do you do for downtime?
I work. I just keep playing. What's your hobbies? Don't got any. A little bit of running, maybe. I run. That's what I do.
Okay, last question right here.
Right, last question. This is it. It's a good one.
Hi, I'm Amahov. And I got two questions. The second one is super short.
Okay.
First one, because I'm not sure who came up with this shock title.
Yeah.
You?
No, Mark.
Oh, because it seems to me like shock is the wrong word here.
Oh,
because it's like more for people like those who thought, oh, 9/11.
Yeah.
And they're driven by what's in yeah. media and tabloids who are looking for shocking people. And here it's like, isn't it more for you, are you driven more by this shock or rather sense of humor and distance and people like, I believe, here?
Well, I think the word shock, I like the word shock because but I just like freaking people out. I like people walking by myself going, what the heck is that? You know, like, I like that look on their face, that body language going, what? you're kidding me? You know, like that, I love that. And if I do have a fan club, which I don't, but if I did.
Do now.
I do not. No, it's retired men that have retired and they're starting woodworking as their second career. They phone me all the time. Can I get the plans? Can I make one of these? Is it okay if I try to build one? A couple of weeks ago, this gigantic biker walked into my studio and his buddy dragging his foot. And they had bandana and leather chaps on. And they got, which one of you's Judson Beaumont? And all my staff just scattered. Yeah. They weren't Judd that day, were they? So this big giant guy's looking at me and I go, did I not pay my phone bill? Like, what the hell? And he goes, and then I said, well, beat me, I'm Judd, you know? And he goes, man, I love you, man. And he gives me this gigantic hug. And he goes, I just drove from northern Saskatchewan on my trike. And with my buddy, and we're going to meet my sister in Seashell, and I GPS'd you, and we found you, man. And then he shows me all my furniture that he's made. Not very well done, I might add. I didn't tell him that. I said, Dad, keep it up. You know. So that was a very funny story. So I like shocking. I like freaking people out. I like when, if I could put a smile on your face, that's all that matters.
That is a great way to end.
I think that
Thank
helps.
You very
okay?
much.
Thank you. Thank you, buddy. Thank you. Thank you.